So with Adam and John now switching places, both in author order and seating as presented.
Yeah.
Well, thanks everyone, thanks John, and thanks Leaf and the organizers here. This has been a great opportunity. I have to say it's also been a kind of weirdly extra thrilling for me. I just started watching Westworld on HBO, and I feel like I'm traveling into hopefully maybe not that space, but it's just a little extra fun here. So what I want to do is talk about some additional work that John and I have been doing, in addition to, with our collaborators here, Ryan Romero Canas and Dylan Lushen Konar at the Environmental Defense Fund at Columbia. I'm a social psychologist. I study group processes and in-group relations, and I'm interested in understanding how group identities shape how we think about environmental problems like climate change, particularly as John alluded to in our work, thinking a little bit beyond the partisan divide, so partisan identities in particular, although we've been looking at their intersection too. We're especially interested in the work I'm going to talk about in understanding how disproportionately affected groups think about an issue like climate change. So John talked about one sort of fundamental misconception, a misconception about the nature of perhaps the partisan divide that we think may pose a barrier to progress on climate change and in public discourse. I'm going to talk about another misconception about which groups care about the environment that we think may pose an additional barrier to broadening public engagement. So over the last week, we've seen far too many images that look like this. This is from Hurricane Harvey, and there'll be unfortunately many more to come from the slew of hurricanes that are following. So thanks to a long history of segregation and discrimination in housing markets and urban development and infrastructure, communities of color and lower income communities are substantially disproportionately affected by a wide range of environmental hazards, including extreme weather events like we witnessed with Hurricane Harvey, that are expected to worsen with climate change. And these images were taken from Houston's George Brown Convention Center. It would be understandable if you were confused and thought you were seeing something from 2005, right, from Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. And it's true that more affluent areas were just far better equipped to manage Harvey's floodwaters. So just to give you a little sense of this, so what I'm showing you here are census tracts in Houston and surrounding Harris County, mostly metropolitan Houston, broken down by median household income. So on the left, you'll see wealthier areas in the south and west in green. On the right, poor areas in the orange and darker orange in the north and east. The red dots here show rescue calls that went out based on Google tracking data I'm about to show you. Right as the hurricane was hitting, through the first 24 hours of the storm. And we can see right away, right, pretty substantial differences in just these regions. And this is just cherry picking some data just to demonstrate a point that we may and will be increasingly, I think, aware of. And if Katrina is any indication, the disparities are going to linger for decades. So the New York Times recently actually reported that only 15% of homeowners in Houston and the Harris County surrounding county have homeowners insurance that covers flood damage. And if we go back in time, we think about Hurricane Katrina's effects in New Orleans. I think the percentages are if we look at the lower Ninth Ward, if you think about where a region that was particularly decimated by the hurricane, only 37% of the mailing addresses that were part of the Postal Service lists in 2005 still exist today. So public opinion surveys suggest that people of color and lower income people are aware of these disproportionate impacts. And as John alluded to, tend to show elevated levels of concern relative to the rest of the US public. At the same time, though, we also see common media portrayals of environmentalists like this, right? These are the people ostensibly working to address the problem or problems around climate change. environmental problems generally. So portrayals of people who are, you know, appear to be white, affluent, and addicted to khaki. So Vanity Fair's now sort of infamous green issue, I think, demonstrates this better than any other media images that I know of. So they profiled 63 prominent environmental activists, and only two of those profiles were people of color, and one was an athlete who was promoting sportswear at the same time. So this just gives you some sort of sense of the incredible disconnect, I think, in what we see in the media images around who's working to tackle these issues. Unfortunately, this is also a story that's partially reflected in occupational data in the US. So these are disparities across the physical sciences based on census data on professional disparities. And in higher education, we often lump science and engineering fields and tech right under the same banner of STEM, especially when we're thinking about disparities. But in fact, if you look across STEM fields, in this case, the physical sciences, you see substantial variability in minority representation across these fields, with some of the greatest disparities occurring in the environmental sector, environmental professional STEM fields, broadly defined, shown here in the red box. So minorities constitute about a third of the US science and engineering workforce, but less than 15% of environmental STEM fields. And the equally, it's about equally low representation, on average 3 to 5% representation, again across these broadly defined fields, among different minority groups, so blacks, Latinos, and Asians. So there seems to be a particularly unique problem going on with disparities in the environmental sector. And work by Dorsetta Taylor and many others, but in particular the Taylor report that came out in 2014, tells a similar story about a green glass ceiling in minority representation, representation of 16% or less, so 16% being the glass ceiling, across the environmental sector, both government and non-governmental sectors. So this is looking at, I think, over 240 different organizations. So this led us to wonder how members of the public, and especially racial and ethnic minorities, perceive minority engagement when it comes to the environment. And this is where perceptions of norms, which we've talked a little bit about, I'm going to unpack a little bit more for those, especially for those in the audience who may not be familiar with this work. This is where in-group norms, we think, come into play. So there's a long history of social psychological research, mostly in the health domain, although there's a large, relatively large burgeoning body of work also in conservation, showing that perceptions of in-group norms matter. So flyers like this are increasingly common. You can probably find them around this campus and just about any campus. And they're aimed at correcting a very common misperception among college undergrads, which is that others are more okay with excessive drinking than they are. It's a misperception because majority of students hold that same viewpoint. And in fact, they seem to be relatively effective at curbing drinking behavior based just purely on that information of what the in-group norm, the campus norm is. So in the 1990s, Debbie Prentice and Dale Miller did some seminal experiments tracking Princeton undergrads, looking at a keg ban that was instituted by the president, attempting to curb binge drinking. If you looked at student editorials, you would think that it was a terrible idea. Students hated this idea, at least on paper. Their private sentiments weren't nearly as negative, though. And what they found is that students who perceive themselves, their viewpoint about the keg ban is deviating from those of their group, the group being the other fellow undergrads, showed a sense of alienation, a sense of feelings of alienation from their group, and increasingly so over time. So reporting less interest in, say, attending alumni events after they graduated, actually attending fewer events on campus during that time period. And some students also conformed in terms of their attitudes, so their attitudes shifting towards a more negative view of the keg ban, starting a more positive view over time, and also some behavioral conformity in that direction too, with reports of more excessive drinking with a shift in attitudes. And then where these perceptions of sort of deviance come into play, people may start to disidentify with the very domains in which they're experiencing that feeling of being potentially alienated, or a feeling of disconnect from their group. So other work has also shown that people may self-silence if they think they're deviating from the group. And norm interventions, as I alluded to, there's a growing body of research in conservation. They seem to be especially promising, though, in conservation fields relative to the health domain of public health. There's a great recent review by Dale Miller and Prentice in this annual review paper, for those of you who are interested in looking at that body, comparing those two bodies of literature, that this may have something to do with the ways that we moralize the environmental space, the environmental sphere, that may enhance concerns about self-validation and really concerns about a need to belong, connect to others, feelings of social approval. And many of us may also be familiar with the implementation of these kinds of norm interventions in conservation. We've already seen some examples of this. So with O-Power, the company based off of Bob Cialdini and Wes Schultz's work, that provides utility companies with energy bills, water bills, other things too, demonstrating how they're stacking up against their neighbors in terms of their energy use or water use. This is my bill, by the way. Doing great. Never mind the fact that several of my competitors, neighbors, are living in duplexes that share a single meter, I recently learned, so. So, surprisingly, there's actually been very little work, and this is the focus I'm going to talk about today, very little work looking at whether perceptions of in-group norms vary across different groups in society. So we have some sense that in-group norms may be important in terms of predicting meaningful behaviors, behaviors also in the conservation realm, but we don't actually know what those norms are. There's very little work looking at that. Work by several different people, Daphne Oyserman and others, suggest that minorities may be especially attuned to racial and ethnic minorities, but minority groups generally may be especially attuned to in-group norms because the consequences may be more severe for them if they feel like they're deviating from their group. So we wanted to know, do these perceptions of norms, environmental norms in particular, vary across groups? Do some groups see themselves collectively as more environmentally concerned and some less so? Are those perceptions accurate? And do they have different implications, potentially, for how people engage with environmental issues generally? So last spring, we fielded another nationally representative survey, a different one from the one that John was talking about. We surveyed, our survey focused on the four largest US racial and ethnic demographic groups, Hispanics and non-Hispanic whites, blacks and Asians. And we measured these groups' general beliefs about who constitutes an environmentalist, who comes to mind when they think about an environmentalist. So looking at racial, ethnic, and class associations with that term. And who's concerned about the environment, environmental issues. So what's the level of concern across different groups if people are rated across different groups? What would their perceptions be? So these are perceived attitudinal norms. We could also call them meta-perceptions. This is perceptions of others' attitudes about the environment, others' concern about the environment. And then we also looked at some additional measures that were related to their perceptions of connecting with, feeling connection with, or in this case, attitudes toward environmental organizations. So how might these perceptions relate to their perceptions of environmental organizations? So I want to show you first perceptions of different demographic groups in the US. What I have here is the x-axis is showing the groups that participants rated. These are the categories, social categories they're rating. And the y-axis is going to show a self-reported concern also the public perception, the average public perception of these groups, level of concern. And this is on a 1 to 5 scale, 1 being not at all concerned to 5, extremely concerned, a simple scale. Also to point out, so we used estimates from the bottom income decile, which is actually below the federal poverty line for households of two or more, as a comparison for poor Americans, and the top income decile groups ratings as a comparison for wealthier Americans. And the blue line showing the moderately concerned, so just as a midpoint comparison. And what we see is that non-whites and lower income Americans indicated among the highest levels of concern. And this is consistent with other public opinion poll findings that John alluded to, we see a very different pattern when we look at public perceptions of who's concerned. Right? The public perception showed almost the opposite pattern here. In some ways, it's sort of, I wouldn't maybe not use this in a sort of a formal way, but you might call this stereotype accuracy, but negative stereotype accuracy. That is, the perception of who is most concerned is a good predictor, perhaps, of who may be less concerned and vice versa. Right, and we can also think about it's not just the groups that are more concerned that are being perceived as less, but also the groups that are most, in many cases, more or most vulnerable to effects of environmental hazards. So the box here is indicating ratings that are below the midpoint of the scale in public perception. We see the same story, identical pattern, if we ask people to rate others concerned about climate change instead of the environment. This was a treatment effect between subjects. So the estimates are a little bit lower, but identical pattern. So groups most concerned and also generally most affected by climate change are perceived to be least concerned. And minority respondents shared this view. So here are the percentages. I'm showing you the percentage of respondents who rated their own environmental concern self as higher than, equal to, or lower than their perception of their own racial or ethnic in-group's concern. And so, and what we see, I'm just going to put all these up here, are non-whites are much more likely to perceive themselves as deviating from their group in terms of being more concerned than other members of their in-group. This is a classic pattern of pluralistic ignorance, terminology used in social psychology to describe this condition. And on the flip side, we see that whites actually show the opposite pattern. They're more likely to report being less concerned about the environment than other whites. And I'll also point out that, so for all three of these groups of respondents, majorities are perceiving themselves, or at least indicating on this survey, that they're holding the minority viewpoint. So this pattern was pretty striking to us. And also just mention that we found a very similar pattern too with income, that is that lower income individuals were much more likely to look like this relative to higher income individuals in their comparisons to their relative income bracket in group, so economic in group. So, you know, where might these perceptions be coming from? Well, one place we thought we would look would be who's coming to mind when people think about the groups that are tackling environmental issues, environmental problems. And so this is showing on the scale the strength of association that participants made between the racial and ethnic categories on the right and the term environmentalists. Three's, again, the midpoint of scale, just to give you a reference. So people generally associate, this is the average aggregate across the US public, generally associated whites with environmentalists and not non-whites. So these are dissociated relative to the midpoint of the scale. And tell us what was particularly striking is it's the same pattern emerges. Strong stereotype consensus across racial and ethnic groups. So you see some variability. Latinos and Asians are indicating stronger associations with their group, their in-group, and environmentalists, but still substantially lower than their associations with whites and environmentalists. The association with whites wasn't so surprising to us given the sort of prominent media that we just saw an example of. That people seem to dissociate minorities with, at least relative to the midpoint of the scale here, with environmentalists was surprising to us and not something we expected. College undergrads, by the way, show this identical pattern of effects. So it seems to be quite pervasive. We also looked at class associations and in particular found consensus in class associations with the term environmentalists. So here, these are different measures, but put on the same scale here. What they're doing is rating the extent to which they associate. So this is for class, so wealth and education, and also the social category age. Who comes to mind, indicating who comes to mind when they think of an environmentalist. So higher scores being older, so very old, to lower scores being very young. So this is relative scales, and then wealthy and educated, and we have across racial and ethnic groups. So generally, I'll put all the data up at once, we see again sort of strong stereotype consensus in the area of class, social class, not so much in terms of age. So people seem to be imagining a, I guess, young-ish person who's moderately wealthy and well-educated. So that seems to be quite consistent in particular. So the class stereotypes seem to be driven by education, which I don't think is something that's talked about much, at least not in the psychological literature. Who actually identifies as an environmentalist? Well, again, we see a far more mixed picture than what the stereotypes might suggest, the stereotypic associations. So blacks are less likely to identify, self-identify as an environmentalist. This is relative to whites. But Latinos and Asians, multiracial, multi-ethnic identified individuals are more likely to. And if we look at income and education, we found no effects for income. Pretty much any way you slice them, just representing it by deciles here, bottom, middle, and top income decile. But, a relatively weak effect for education. So you see actually slightly more extremes at the ends. So people with less than a high school education or more than a bachelor's. But if you treat this linearly, so these are our categories, but if you look at it, say, by degree attainment, level of degree attainment, you see a weak, relatively weak linear positive effect. So these stereotypic associations, these perceptions, don't seem to track reality very well, at least in relative to self-identified, who's a self-identified environmentalist. What they do track quite well, though, is they're strongly correlated with perceptions of group attitudes. Again, this is correlational, but in particular, stereotypes that people hold, perceptions people hold of their own racial ethnic in-group are a good predictor, a very strong predictor, on average 0.5 to 0.8. Of these perceptions of how much does that group, in this case my group, how much is my group concerned about the environment. So people may be inferring attitudes about members of society, including the attitudes of their own group, in part through thinking about who's coming to mind when I think about the kinds of people who are tackling these problems. We looked at, as I mentioned, also some additional downstream potential social psychological correlates, so some implications for organizational engagement. And we found that generally whites' perceptions, this was true also for non-whites, but a weaker effect, but whites' perceptions in particular, their perceptions of non-white minorities predicted how much support they indicated for diversity initiatives in environmental organizations. So, and in particular, you can see the wording of the question here is about groups tackling climate change, but indicating that it's a value. And you could sort of think about maybe where the logic may be coming from in this. We don't have data to really be able to unpack this yet, but it may be thinking that, you know, why invest resources to recruit diverse, more diverse membership if those individuals aren't all that concerned about this issue. So the logic might go, right? Perception might. And among non-whites, we found that their perceptions of their in-group concern, but not other groups' concerns, so uniquely predicted their attitudes toward environmental organizations, so more positive attitudes with more perceptions that their group cares about the environment. And also a sense of that they would be valued in these organizations, which is, think of it as a proxy for a feeling of belonging, a sense of belonging in them. So these findings suggest, stereotypes that, and strong consensus in stereotypes about minority engagement that seem to be shared across majority and minority groups. And the last thing I wanted to talk about was what might be some motivational implications. So I'll briefly talk about a quick follow-up study here. And we wanted to, in particular, sort of explore, again, motivational implications. So what might motivate or demotivate people in the realm of pro-environmentalism in the area of the environment, and thinking about pro-environmentalism, when we're bringing in the notion of racial ethnic identity into this mix. So we drew from work on identity-based motivation, which posits that people are more likely to engage in behaviors that they perceive as compatible with their group identity, so in-group congruent. So Daphne Oyserman and her colleagues have studies with low-income kids, for example, and low-income Black and Latino kids in public schools in Detroit, showing that they perceive healthy eating and also healthy exercise as not identity congruent, not something that people like them do. And they report engaging in more healthful behaviors more And in also engaging on the flip side in more unhealthy eating habits when their race or ethnic identity is made salient in surveys and experiments. So we wanted to see if something like this might also happen in the environmental domain. So whether perceptions of the compatibility of the environmental domain with my group identity, perhaps coming from stereotypic views about who's engaged, would predict non-whites' pro-environmental motivations. And to tap identity compatibility, we used Susan Clayton's environmental identity scale that's used a lot in identity work in the environment. So this really sort of taps into notions of feeling connection with or commonality with other with groups that are working to address environmental issues and also the environment generally. So we administered that to a diverse online sample pool of US adults. And then we also administered a modified version of that where we swapped out the eyes for my racial or ethnic identity to get a sense of group compatibility, group identity compatibility with the domain of the environment. And then also asking a series of questions about, you know, to what extent could they see themselves engaging in a variety of environmentally friendly behaviors in the upcoming year. So from individual types of behaviors like recycling to more social behaviors like being active in an environmental organization. So again, in this case, we're comparing whites relative to non-whites. And we're looking to see here whether people perceived environmentalism as something that's identity compatible or congruent with this measure and whether that predicted environmental engagement. And what we found is that generally there was a main effect on this measure, so that whites typically scored higher on this group environmental identity measure. They perceived the environment as more identity congruent relative to non-whites. But how much whites associated their racial ethnic in-group with the environment didn't predict their pro-environmental engagement on those Gallup measures. What did was their personal environmental identity, the original Clayton scale. For non-whites, though, we see that how they viewed the connection of the environment as a domain to their group, the relationship to their group, the more they perceived their group, this domain as identity compatible, the more they personally identified with the environment as a domain, and that then accounted for mediated effects on environmental engagement. So when it comes to environmentalism, non-whites may be especially attuned again to the perceived norms of their group, or in this case, the compatibility of their group identity with this entire domain, this sphere. And then last, we also injected a treatment here too. Very simple manipulation, used a lot in social psychological research, especially in stereotype threat kinds of work, where we varied whether we asked them to indicate their race or ethnicity either at the beginning of the survey or at the end. So either they're answering this our survey questions, thinking about their race or ethnicity, right, or having that perhaps in the background, or at least more so. And what we found was minorities who are primed with their race or ethnicity, meant to think of their race or ethnicity at the beginning of the survey, showed a lower level of engagement on that Gallup measure relative to the control group. And we found no effect of this experimental treatment on whites. And you can see also this is a trend not quite significant in the control groups where non-whites are actually reporting higher levels of engagement on our surveys. So just some sort of concluding thoughts here. So John mentioned that we're a rapidly diversifying society, right? We'll soon be a minority nation and very soon for the under 18 population by 2020, including members of traditionally underrepresented groups in decision-making processes isn't just important for equity reasons. It's important for those reasons, but right, the questions of what kinds of problems are even being considered or thought of. But it's also important, we know from social psychology, in terms of thinking about engaging large and fast-growing segments of the US public with these problems through organizations that are working to address them. So how do you increase public support for groups that have environmental initiatives or solidarity with those groups? Thinking about these kinds of identity processes we think are critical to thinking about which groups in particular are going to be more versus maybe less inclined to support environmental initiatives. So there are sort of a series of, I think our work suggests that there are actually two kinds of effects in particular that we think of as sort of invisible barriers or hidden barriers to engagement in many ways. So one may be these perceptions, meta-perceptions, perceptions of others, attitudes in this case, about the environment, a tendency to substantially underestimate the environmental concerns of the most impacted groups, most vulnerable groups, and groups that are actually among the most concerned, and perceiving these groups as least concerned. And maybe even more importantly for us is that finding that there's stereotype consensus across majority and minority groups in these perceptions, both on the attitude measure and also the stereotypic associations. These perceptions may have some social costs. Right? For majority group members, it may reduce their support for diversity initiatives, which may seem perfectly rational to the perceiver in this case. Right? If they're thinking about what to invest resources in, you know, perhaps they shouldn't be focusing on, the logic would be, groups that aren't as engaged, aren't as concerned. Right? So we can see where the stereotypes may be quite meaningful on the organizational end internally. And then for minorities, these perceptions, we think, in some ways expose a catch-22, and that is, you know, if we know that at least large portions of the non-white U.S. public shows elevated levels of concern, you know, do they conform to the perception, in this case, perhaps the misperception of environmental concern, and reduce their attitudes or engagement, or do they risk feeling alienated from their group? And these may be some of the kinds of questions that people may be asking themselves, maybe not quite as explicitly as this, but may help to account for some of the other findings in public opinion work, for example, that show that non-whites, this is across racial and ethnic minority groups that we studied, indicate that they're less willing to talk about climate change among their family and friends, especially if they think it's going to be a contentious conversation, relative to whites. So majority whites say they would be okay, sort of enthusiastic actually in those surveys, in talking about a contentious issue like climate change among a very intimate audience, and non-whites less so. So we think some of these norm processes may be at play. But we're dealing with perceptions, so we think, you know, in part the good news here, I guess, would be those may be malleable. We know from John spoke to work on scientific consensus messaging. We know that, and that's been argued as sort of a gateway belief toward support for environmental policies, climate policies in particular. We think there are other kinds of consensus messaging that may be as important, perhaps more, for some groups. So thinking more broadly about social consensus messaging and about, you know, what are the group norms? Who are the group norms that we're trying to follow? Who are the important reference groups for the person who's thinking about an issue like climate change? So thinking about that as a space for intervention, I think is particularly promising, and we're starting some work with Latino groups in San Antonio to look at first testing sort of replication of these effects at a more local level among community civic leaders as a reference group, their perceptions of each other. And then also looking to see that if there are misperceptions, if correcting those misperceptions can enhance civic and political engagement on environmental problems. So we think there's lots of potential for growth here. Thank you. We have at least time here.
Yeah, take a few questions and we'll turn this back on.
I was just wondering about the use of the word environment, or whether the environment as a term means the same thing to different groups.
Yeah.
I just want to give a little anecdotal thing here in Boulder County. Sorry, this issue came up of how different ethnic groups engage their environment locally. Like some people go hiking because they like to see birds and wildlife or whatever. Some people go for the exercise. It turns out Hispanic groups really love to use parks for picnics and group activities. And it's a whole different way of using the outdoors, and it means different things for the kinds of policies and kinds of facilities you provide. So I'm just curious about if you know anything about how different groups perceive the environment when you ask them whether they're an environmentalist or whether they're,
yeah,
they care about
so
the environment.
Yeah, so we didn't look at that in these data, but we left it general on purpose for this very reason, so that there is there's other research that suggests that, for instance, if you're thinking about the environment among whites and more affluent people, more educated people too, they think of uninhabited spaces,
right.
You know, somewhere far, far away, usually looks gorgeous. Right, they're not typically thinking about urban areas, where you see more thinking about urban, especially urban effects, impacts. So risk perceptions of pollution, of water contamination, soil contamination. So that's been borne out in other opinion research, but I think it's certainly not a settled question to us what might be driving in particular the sort of perceptions people have about the attitudes of other people. So
right.
You start
they might be thinking about like a certain caring about the nature,
right.
Bare spaces.
Yeah.
So that's not my group.
Right.
My group cares this way.
Right.
They care, but you know, it just really matters what people mean when they answer.
Right, which may have implications for communication. Right.
Right.
There.
Let's take one more and then
sure.
We'll switch over. So part of what you know obviously is interesting is how there's this sort of stereotype or idea that white people are more environmental, and so once you see the graph where they report their own concern, it's not like that doesn't seem to be the case, and the bar seems to be lower even. Do you have a sense of whether once you separate that in order to get a better look at the issue of the increased polarization within that group, whether there is this subgroup, say the liberal whites, that are they actually more concerned than everyone else? So it's like, just in terms of thinking about how that stereotype is formed, is it that there's this subgroup of whites that is the only thing that people are focusing on?
Yeah, so we have, I think I had an extra slide, but I'm glad you didn't, so I wouldn't keep going. I'll make this a real quick answer, which is that we've collected data actually looking at, so other, you know, adding other groups on political dimensions too. Certainly Democrats, so we're looking at party level. Those data were with undergrads who sometimes don't understand what a conservative versus a liberal is. So asking about party is, right, so they see green means white, middle class, well-educated Democrat. So it's a very, very narrow view. And that's an actually more extreme stereotype. This is of the term environmentalist, more extreme stereotype, exclusive stereotype than stereotypes about scientists, we asked about, and engineers, those terms, where you see substantially more variability, people willing to associate other groups with those terms. Yeah.
I think that's,
yeah.
Sorry.
We'll hold that a little bit later. Thank you again.